Squatchy Cartoon Obsession. Hello everybody, my name is Nathan, and I am the man with a cartoon obsession. I promised you all at the end of my last video that I'd talk about a horror series that wasn't child-friendly. Considering that the subject of today's review was rated TV-MASV here in the US, I'd say it's rather far removed from child-friendly. However, that also means that I'm going to throw in a graphic content warning, and I'm also going to throw in a spoiler warning because I can guarantee that spoilers will find their way into this review. Now that I got all that out of the way, let's get into my anime review of Elfen Lied. Elfen Lied, which is German and Dutch for Elves' Song or Song of the Elves, is an anime series based on the manga of the same name. The name comes from an old poem called Elfen Lied that was composed into a song, and that song is featured in the story. The anime was produced by Studio Arms, which unfortunately just went under a couple months ago, and it was dubbed and originally licensed by ADV Films here in the States, but now it is currently licensed by Sentai Filmworks. The series aired from July 25th, 2004 to October 17th, 2004 over the course of 13 episodes, and there was also an OVA that was released on April 21st, 2005. More often than not, OVAs are just extra filler episodes for the fans, but if you haven't seen the Elfen Lied OVA or the series at all and plan to do so, I strongly recommend that you watch the OVA because it features some story elements that help things make more sense. With that, let's get into the story. In this anime, there is a species, or I guess subspecies of human, called the Diclonius, or Diclonii. This is a genetic mutation, also referred to as a virus or disease in the series, that is identified by the horns on their head. They also have invisible arms called vectors, but I'll talk about those a bit more later. The Diclonius Research Institute researches these beings, but they don't do it in a humane way. The main Diclonius, Lucy, escapes the research facility, but not before she takes a bullet to the head. When she's found by Coda, who just moved for college, and his cousin Yuka, she doesn't remember anything. Her facial expression is different, and all she can say is new, which is what Coda and Yuka call her. That's because the head trauma caused Lucy to have a split personality. The research facility wants to retrieve Lucy and use any means to do so. The other part of the story is that Coda can't remember any details from a part of his childhood involving the death of both his sister and his father. His memories do return over time, kind of the same way Lucy's split personalities get triggered. If they see or hear something that sparks a memory, they either space out or freak out for a second, and they go back to the way they were. I guess I should explain the Diclonii a little more. Well, I mentioned their horns, and I also mentioned these invisible arms called vectors. Vectors are powerful weapons that can cut through solid rock, use objects as projectiles, or literally tear people limb from limb, and believe me, that happens a lot. They also have a tendency to develop a bloodlust and can end up going on a murderous rampage, but it hasn't been shown to come up unprovoked. This is where the Diclonius Research Institute comes in. Whenever a Diclonius is born, they take it in, do research, perform horrific tests on them, essentially torture them, and even kill them. Their purpose, on the surface at least, is to create a vaccine and find a cure for this virus. But the director has a hidden agenda that's much different. There are a lot more elements that go into the story, and I'm sure some will briefly come up while I'm talking about other aspects of the show. But just know that it's a complex story. Another aspect of the show that's complex is its cast of characters. I'll start with Coda. He's a college student who, like I said, can't remember a big part of his childhood when his sister and father died. He lives in his cousin's family's home while he's in town for college. He's shown to be very kind-hearted and helps everyone he can. His cousin is Yuka, and she's a kind-hearted person as well. Although she's a bit harsh on Coda when it comes to the way he acts around other girls.
Well, well. A love affair. Isn't that just terrific?
It wasn't me! I swear, you started it!
Despite that, she still cares for her cousin very deeply. They encounter some others who they end up befriending, such as Mayu. She ran away from home and only had a dog named Wanta as a companion. She's a sweet girl, very nice and innocent. Another one who falls under that category, for the most part anyway, is Nana, another Diclonius. She's one who doesn't really have that bloodlust I mentioned earlier. She says that she's not capable of killing anybody, and all she really wants to do is please her papa. That refers to Chief Kurama, who is a character I really feel for toward the end of the series. He's heavily involved in the Dyclonius research, and he was responsible for numerous Dyclonius deaths. However, he's clearly hurting inside, and by the end of the series, he's been redeemed as far as I'm concerned. Chief Kakuzawa, on the other hand, does not get that same conclusion. He's the director of the Dyclonius Research Institute, and while he doesn't get directly involved in much of the action, he plays the role of the evil boss well. He's vindictive and he's excellent at being threatening. He also explains that his real goal is to restart the human race with the Dyclonii, and in order to do so, he needs Lucy. It's a rather twisted plan, but like I said, he plays the villain role well. My favorite villain in the series, though, is Bondo. Bondo is an operative for the National Police Agency's Special Assault Team. He has a bloodlust that rivals that of a Dyclonius. His mission is to eliminate Lucy, and he has no problem taking out anybody else who gets in his way. He's an asshole who doesn't care about anybody, but he has a certain charm about him that I just can't hate. He's a bad guy, but an enjoyable bad guy.
What, kill? What do you mean, kill?
Isn't it obvious, dumbass? The word kill means I pull the trigger. The gun goes off, and your brains splatter all over the sand. The beach gets bloody, and you get dead.
Finally, I have to talk about Lucy. What a tragic backstory she has. She was mistreated her whole life, and yes, she is a murderer, but it's nearly impossible not to sympathize with her. Lucy is one of my favorite anime characters of all time, because her backstory and development is handled so well. Now, if you really want to get complex, let's talk about the relationships between some of these characters. The biggest one is between Lucy / New and Coda. Coda protects New and takes care of her like a friend, guardian, and maybe even an older sibling type of figure. However, through flashbacks, it's revealed that Coda and Lucy met before when they were kids. Even as New, Lucy ends up remembering some parts of the past. Coda was Lucy's first real human friend, but their relationship is rather complicated, especially toward the end of the series. Coda's relationship with his cousin Yuka is also complicated. Yuka's in love with Coda, point blank. That causes her to get jealous whenever Coda is around other girls, especially New. It's a bit strange, and honestly, it's one of the few problems I have with the series. That being said, I don't hate every encounter between Coda and Yuka. They do have some nice bonding moments, and Yuka's jealousy can offer much-needed comic relief in an otherwise tense series.
I'm happy. New seems to be doing fine.
Yuka, hold on. This isn't what
you- It looks like I'm interrupting. I'll just be going.
What are you implying?
The last relationship I want to talk about is the one between Nana and Chief Kurama. Earlier I said that Kurama was Nana's papa. He's not her biological father, but he does act like her father, and he does a great job at being her father figure. I love the bond that these two share, and it's obvious that Kurama really thinks of Nana as his own daughter. Now let's talk about the visuals. I don't know why, but I have such a soft spot for that early to mid-2000s anime art style. The eyes look bigger and everything just has this look to it where you can tell roughly when the series was made. I guess that can apply to a lot of anime, but what I'm saying is I love the art style and the animation. The characters and backgrounds both look eye-catching, and the animation is clean just about all the way through. There are a couple minor animation errors here and there, but nothing to get upset over. Honestly, you might not even notice them upon first glance. Onto the audio portion now. I absolutely adore the music used in this anime. There are a few different versions of the same song being used, but it's just so impactful and really fits the tone of the show. I also enjoy the voice acting in the English dub. It may feel a little dated to some, but for me, it holds up. My personal favorite performances are Jason Douglas as Bondo and Kira Vincent Davis as Lucy. In fact, this is my favorite role of hers, personally. The anime isn't exactly perfect. I did mention the minor animation errors from time to time, and the weird and sometimes unsettling relationship between Coda and Yuka, although that's mostly one-sided. The only other issue I have with the series is its ending. It has one of those cliffhanger go-read-the-manga endings, which I do intend to read at some point. But still, if I'm watching the anime, I want to see the conclusion in the anime. At the same time, though, I also kind of like the cliffhanger ending a bit. It seems fitting to me, but boy, what I wouldn't give for a continuation. Overall, though, Elfen Lied really is a gem. If you haven't seen it, I highly recommend you watch it. But I'll say this. It's one of the most brutal anime I've ever seen. I'm not just talking about the blood and gore either, even though the show has that in abundance. I'm also talking about the themes they portray here, such as abuse, prejudice, social alienation, and just the value of humanity as a whole. It's a lot to take in, and it really makes you think. There's also a fair amount of nudity in the series, so if that's something you don't like, it also might be rough to watch. I normally don't care for excessive nudity myself, but it's justified here more often than not. Since the Diclonized Vectors can use objects as projectile weapons, it makes sense as to why they wouldn't be wearing clothes. If you think you can handle all of this, though, and keep in mind there are plenty other things that I didn't even mention, I highly recommend this series if you either haven't seen it or are thinking about rewatching it. Keep this in mind too, when I rewatched this again for my review, that was my fourth time watching this show, and I still shed a few tears. That means it's either a really powerful show, or I'm just a big softy. Who's to say? Overall, I give Elfen Lied a 97 out of 100. At the moment, I consider this to be my favorite anime of all time. That might change in the future, but for the time being, this is the cream of the crop as far as I'm concerned.
Coda? Jerk? What are you crying for? You're supposed to be a guy! And guys aren't supposed to cry. Because if you keep crying, I'm going to...
Thank you guys so much for watching the video. If you have any other cartoons, anime, or other animated works that you want me to talk about in the future, please let me know. After all, it's not my channel, it's our channel. Don't forget to like, comment, subscribe, and feel free to check out my social media pages, audition for an outro, and join the official Cartoon Obsession Discord, the links for all of which are in the description below. Thanks again for watching, and I'll see you all next time.
I am Vegeta, and thank you for watching Cartoon Obsession. Is it over now? Can I quit?